You're all going to be worth $10 million in about an hour. That's very exciting news. You didn't know you were going to get an automatic raise. You probably didn't know you were worth $1 million when you came in the room. So my name is Jen Dalton. Make sure, there we go. I quit my corporate job 10 years ago. It was not sexy or exciting retail. It was actually financial services. And the reason I left was because I wanted to go start something that had meaning to me. So when I talk to you today about your personal brand and how do you build it for career success, it's because I really care that you leave this room ready to go become that $10 million brand. How many people remember their favorite professor? You could probably tell me the name. Anybody want to shout out the name of their favorite professor? Give them some credibility, some credit. Say louder. Blylock. Blaylock. Could you give me like an easier name, but that's all right. D. Warmack. Okay, this is all in perpetuity. It's recorded on video. I would ask you for your least favorite professors, but I'm sure you probably don't want to have that come back and bite you. My point is that everybody really knows when you're amazing, and everybody really knows when something's not right. So when you think about building your brand and building a positive reputation, you don't want to be the bad high school or college professor. Remember that good news travels fast. How many of you have already started your job day one? So you're all getting ready to, so some of you have, okay. And the rest of you are getting ready to, right? So how do you start on the right foot? What I want to talk about today are five key concepts. These are just for you. No one else has ever seen this, okay? Know yourself. This is going to be a little deep, people, but you can handle it. I promise. First impressions last. I'm going to go through each of these. Be a noise breaker, not a noise maker. Stand out to get in. Now, luckily, all of you have gotten in, but now what's next? What's the next opportunity you need to get into? And lastly, the art of the pause. Okay? I'm going to go through these, and I'm going to ask you guys to also do some exercises. Not physical, mental, so don't worry. Okay? When we think about personal branding, it's really about association. So now I'm going to play a game because I like fun stuff. Okay? I'm going to put a word up on the screen, and I want you to shout the first word that comes to mind. Don't hold back. Ready? One, two. Sports, athletic shoes. Just do it. Does anybody ever feel like they can just do it after they buy Nike? Yes, I've bought it, but I've not been able to do it yet. But I'm hoping, right? How about this? Online, books. Did you say fashion? Fast shipping. Yeah, I was like, fashion, they do have clothes. Drones. Oh. Right? Jeff Bezos, Amazon, everything. Absolutely. So these are really corporate brands, right? And we think about a corporate brand, there is a connection and words do come to mind. Let's move a little bit into the corporate, but also a person. Class, shoes, what else? Comfy, luxury, yeah. This is my next, the next one is my favorite. Red bottoms, thank you. One of the most like shared DIY videos is how to paint the bottom of your shoes red. So there are these people who have a corporate brand, right? You think of Steve Jobs. There is no way Apple will be what it is today without his brand, okay? Now for this next column, these last two, I want you to really shout it out. These are true personal brands. One is in the corporate space and one is not. And I'll give you the first name. Richard Branson. Virgin. Somebody said they don't know. Okay, go Google. Richard Branson, crazy, crazy good hair. Definitely a risk taker. Does anybody think Richard Branson would drive a Volvo? No. I drive a Volvo, but he would not drive a Volvo. He probably has a either green car or very fast, or a very fast green car. Taylor Swift. Country, really? Shake It Off. Louder. Happy. Business savvy. Victoria's Secret show, she did sing at that. What did she just leave? Spotify. Who else has the brand clout to be able to make that decision and not have her customers leave her? I can't really think of anybody. Well, maybe Beyonce. She hasn't left Spotify yet, I don't think. But for Taylor Swift, when she launched 1989, she went and had little mini release parties with her customers. So when you think about somebody amazing to emulate when it comes to retail, customer experience, owning your brand, she is pretty darn remarkable. This is why this is important. Every day when you go to work, every day when you interact, it doesn't matter who it's with. If you do not define your brand on your terms, other people will define it for you. How many people want their coworkers to define their brand? You might if they all like you, but if they're not really clear on the value you bring and the purpose you have, it will be hard for them to really sell you. How many people here have a mom? I'm hoping everyone, okay. No, aliens. I could ask my mom to be my chief marketing officer. She knows a lot about me. I am never, ever going to do that. First of all, she doesn't know what Facebook is or Twitter. It would be terrible. But that's not who I want owning my brand. It's my job. You are a million-dollar brand. You are your own company. You are the CEO of you. It is not anybody else's job to own your reputation except for you. When we think about reputation, it really is this idea of perception and reality. You have your own idea of who you are, right? What's your name? Dylan. Tell me how amazing you are in one word. What's one word that you would use to describe yourself?
Innovative.
Innovative. Would people around you say you're innovative?
Yes.
Everyone?
Not the people that don't know you.
Fair enough. So when you think about your brand, it's perception. It's how others think about you. It's really important to understand that 90% of your brand is what everybody else thinks about you. It's not just what you think about you. You can be amazing, but if other people don't get it or know it, it's not going to work. So throw out some words. What is a personal brand? Throw out some other words. I gave you an easy one that starts with an R.
Reputation.
Reputation. What else?
Style.
That might be on my list. Louder. Sorry? Image, yes. It's also what people expect from you. Consistency. A company has just hired you to come work for them. Every day you come in and you do something consistently, now they're going to have expectations that you can deliver certain things. What else? There's another word. Sorry?
Quality.
Quality. Could be, hopefully. You stand out. That would be a good thing, right? A personal brand is about standing out. It's about being unique or different. How different are you? We all had probably high school chemistry teachers, but they were all fundamentally different. It still didn't make me like mine anymore, but they all approached it in a different way. So just because a lot of you are in merchandising doesn't mean you're all unique and different, and doesn't mean you bring your own thoughts. You have your own point of view. What is yours going to be when you go to work every day? What's the value you're going to bring? What's the perception you're going to create? And here's the most important one. Because branding is about emotions. How are you going to make people feel? When I say Volvo, what's the word you think of? Safety. That has nothing to do with a steering wheel or a chair or tires. It has to do with an outcome. I bought a Volvo because I have two children and a husband, and I want to keep us all safe. The Subaru commercial. Anybody seen the latest Subaru commercial in the last 3 months? What was the tagline? Anybody? Louder? They lived. You guys don't have kids yet, so it's not going to be relevant. But they lived. It's an emotional connection. It has nothing to do with what the Subaru can do or the quality of the tires. So your reputation is emotional. I'm going to come back to this later. When we talk about knowing yourself, it's really about discovering your identity, You're going to be going through this process forever. The good news is we're talking about it today because I want you to think about it moving forward. There are clients I work with that are 30, 40, 50 that wish they can go back to you right now, your age, and start over. So discover your brand. All right, so I'm going to have worksheets be passed out. And we're going to have the lights come up a little bit because we are going to do an exercise. I never go anywhere without an exercise. Worksheets out, and you guys already have them? Yay! Okay. On one side of the worksheet is a quiz. I'm going to walk around and help you guys. I want you to take the quiz super fast. You guys are millennials. I know you're super quick and agile. Don't overthink it. The first question is going to be around, do you have a written purpose? I'm going to lean over you. Okay? If you do, and you probably don't, but if you do and you love it and it's awesome, circle the 10. If you don't worry about it. Put a zero. This is all safe space, all secret, nothing gets shared. Go through each of those and circle. 10 points for awesome, 7 points if it's close. Sorry, 5 points. 1 point if it's fine. It's okay. It's not great. I literally mean, did you write down your purpose as an individual? How do you want to show up as a leader? I literally mean written down leadership purpose. When you get to something like narrative, what's her name? Naomi. I might ask Naomi to tell me about herself. Can you tell me about yourself in less than 30 seconds in a compelling way? When you see narrative, thank you, Naomi. When you see narrative, that's what I'm talking about. Written values. So you have them written down?
Yeah, it was an exercise.
Oh, so you already, good. Resume, you guys all should know that one. Communication plan, any other questions on some of the other pieces? Superpower. Superpower is one word, no kidding, clarity. My superpower is gutsy. When I work with my clients, I have to think big for them. You're good. What would be your one-word superpower? Maybe it's perspective. Maybe it's innovation, creative thinking. I know that's two words. We're going to hyphenate it. So that's superpower. You may not have that. You may not have gone through that exercise. That's okay. But it's important to know, no kidding, what are you good at? All right. Anybody over 125? You had a lot of 10 circled. But you're not, you haven't added it up yet. Add it up when you're done. Add it up, please. Anybody over 125? Why did I make you take a quiz? You thought this was going to be a fun, easy session. These are all of the things that you really need in your brand toolkit. You can build your toolkit over time, but it's really important to have these written values, to have these things written down. How many people went out and fixed their social media profile before they applied for a job? Yay! Hopefully the rest of you already had a great social media profile and you did not raise your hand for that reason. Anybody over 100? Some people. Anybody over 75? Over 50. Okay, so you're not supposed to get 150, all right? But I want you to use this and take it away with you and think about how am I intentionally owning and building my brand over time? Be thoughtful of the gaps that not doing these things can create. By the way, out of curiosity, how many people have a LinkedIn profile? That's good. I was told actually that you guys didn't usually have one, so that's highly impressive. Fantastic work. How many of you got your job through LinkedIn? Not so many. Okay. Here's a hard question. This is the only truly deep slide. Okay. If you can answer one of these statements or fill it in with your answer, this is what you're trying to do. I exist to finish the sentence. Why are you here? If you already know the answer and you want to write it down, I did leave space on the worksheet. If you don't, these are the things to think about in your next 1, 2, 3, 4 jobs. Because it's not just about the job, it's about you. Maybe you know what kind of leader you want to be. I am a, what kind of leader? Can someone give me a verb here? You want to be known as what kind of leader? Adjective? Sorry? Empowering leader. I am an empowering leader who, how would you be empowering? By making everything easy. Is that empowering? So remove obstacles. Love it. Okay, perfect. Maybe there's something wrong in the world that you see that you want to fix. And you want to fix it by using your skills A, B, and C. My point is, think about these things. It's really important. No one else is going to do it for you. What is your current brand? This is an exercise I do with my clients. It's very powerful. Think of five words to describe yourself. They might look something like this. Creative. Dylan earlier said innovative. Structured, architect. On the back side of your worksheet, the first column at the top, write down these five words for me. How would you describe yourself? They might be positive, they could also be constructive. Maybe there's one thing you wish you could work on. Maybe you're direct, which being direct can be good, but it can also have consequences. This is an easy exercise to do, and I highly recommend it. Raise your hand when you're done. What's your name?
Armand.
Armand, would you mind sharing your five words? Can I put you on the spot?
Yeah, sure. All right. I said I was helpful, fun, positive, technical, and open.
Helpful, fun, positive, technical, and open. Thank you very much. Applause for Armand for being brave and gutsy. Anybody else want to share their five words? Yes. What's your name?
Mariah.
Mariah. Go ahead.
Influential, passionate, driver, people-oriented, and accountable.
Love it. Some of these words are really positive. Can a driver also have negative consequences if you're a driver? When we think about a superpower or a power, a skill you have, recognize that sometimes they can be perceived as negative. So if you're working with your peers, you might say you're structured, and they might say, yeah, Jen, you're really structured. You're a little bit OCD structured. You bring these worksheets to these workshops, a little too much. I might think, well, you know, I'm really creative. Someone else might say, you're insightful. So here's my question for you. In the next column, I want you to think about this. Write down five words that you think other people would use to describe you. Now, normally I would go out and interview people and ask them for my clients. But this is a really important skill. When you start your new job and you start to make friends or coworkers, don't be afraid to say, hey, what's your name?
Veronica.
Do you like coffee?
Yeah.
Can we get coffee? Because I'd love to get some feedback from you on how you think I'm doing. Is that all right?
Yeah.
Excellent. I'll buy coffee. I'll buy your coffee. We're going to go have coffee, and I'm going to say, hey, I'm really trying to work on how my reputation is and how I'm showing up. Would you mind, like, giving me some words that you would use to describe me? And hear what she says. This is super easy. It's not a performance management review, which you'll have at some point. So think about this. Anybody have a word in the middle column that was different than the first five they put down? Or did you guys all give yourself the same ones because everything's happy? Different word? What were your words, if you don't mind sharing, Monica?
Other people would say
mm-hmm.
Good work ethic, listener, and strategic, insightful, and planner.
So these are all happy words.
Oh, well.
That's okay. They can be happy. I'm sure people like you. Well, if I look at driven and work ethic, good work ethic, those are similar. You have achiever. Is that right?
That's on this side.
Empathetic, strategic. Okay. So there's definitely alignment, but go out and listen. What I find, and it's totally fine, I'm sure people like you. I like your five words. I find about 80% of the time, people see you how you think they see you. It's the 20% that you've got to be listening for, that you don't want to surprise you, especially in your performance management review. So think about what would you ask people, and what would they say, and be open to it. I'm going to come back to why that's so important and why people that have hired you, what they're looking for you from a skills standpoint. First impressions last. How many times, if you have a bad first impression, does it take to unwind it? Anybody know? Seven. Who said seven? Ooh, I have a book to give to you later. Come see me. Good job. Seven times. So think about that. If you go into a meeting and you're not really prepared, and you say something without really thinking, and you make a bad first impression, it's going to take you seven good impressions to unwind that. Now, I'm not saying don't speak. I'm just saying think about it before you speak, or when you get dressed, or whatever that is, that first impression. Bill talked about it earlier. How do you go introduce yourself? Eye contact, firm handshake, loudly, clearly enunciate your name. Same thing. That's a first impression. Your brand is never just about you. I talked about this idea of you and your brand as a CEO. You're the CEO of you. But keep in mind, you're also now representing a company. You are officially a brand ambassador. That means really being thoughtful and understanding the company's values, what's important to them, and how they want you to show up. How you show up to clients, to customers, every interaction. Everything is digital now, nothing is private. The tweet, the Facebook post, the thing you put on LinkedIn, how you show up at a networking event, you now embody both brands. So be thoughtful about that as you go into the workforce. Last exercise, I want you to pick five words that are going to describe you 12 months from now, that you want to be known for in your new role 12 months from now. I challenge you to pick different words than the ones you have in the first two columns, or at least be really intentional. Think about, how do I want to show up? How do I want to be perceived? And pick those five words for me, please. Monica, any new words? Can you share? Courageous. Susan would like that from earlier. Detail-oriented. That's a great one, right? Especially in retail. We heard earlier, right? We've got to pay attention to the numbers, the details, that all matters. What else?
Caring.
Thought-provoking. Dig it. Ambitious. So these are now all words that start to take on more of a career tone, how you're showing up consistently in your job. So constantly go back and revisit this list, ask how you're being perceived, and ask how you want to be, what you want to be known for. How do you want to show up? Maybe it's as the creative person. Maybe it's as the team player. Be thoughtful about it. Now, Monica mentioned being a thought leader, right? I call this being a noisemaker. Noise breaker, not a noise maker. You can go out and add to the clamor all you want and make a lot of noise. I think we get inundated with 7 billion bits of information every day, stimuli. It's not about making noise. If you're going to add to a conversation, if you're going to add your thoughts, have them be intentional and break through the noise, add value. You want to add as a part of the orchestra, not part of the clamor. So think about what you're going to say when you write a paper, when you give a presentation. How are you adding your thoughts to be a noise breaker, not a noise maker? Think about, what could I talk about? You're going to go into this new organization, this new company, and learn things about it that are going to be company related. They might be about new digital technologies they're bringing online. Think about what your department is talking about. But it's not just that. You might want to talk about, as a contributor to your new company, things you're really good at. Maybe you're fantastic at PR or social media or videos. Maybe you're great at building teams. What are the skills you bring that you can convert and add value to the company? You might be completely passionate about your job, and that would be awesome. You may also have other passions outside of your work. How are you building your brand in these three dimensions? This is a way to think about how you're showing up. Maybe outside of work, you love to ski, or you love wine, or you love new restaurants, or you love certain music. Think about how you're building your reputation on each of these dimensions. And maybe you want to focus on the company related and not the others, but this is a great way to structure the conversation that you're having and how you're breaking through the noise. Now, here's one of the things that most people fail at. Evidence. How do you have evidence of your reputation? So once you figure out what you should talk about, whether it's company skill or passions, how do you create evidence that shows you've started to master or become an expert in that? Now, right now, you're not an expert yet. You might be an expert in something, but chances are you're going into retail and you're learning something new. So think about, what is it you want to be an expert in? Who is the expert now, especially in the company, that you might want to go talk to, interview, grab that coffee with? How do you start to build your expertise, and then how do you start to create evidence of that expertise? Do you become the expert at something in your department or on your team? You want to be indispensable, but not just for one topic. You don't want to be a generalist, but you do want to pick one or two things to really go deep on and to have a mastery of. So just a thought, so think about that. We've talked a lot about you. It's also important to think about your audience. When you go to a meeting, when you're sending an email, when you're presenting at a conference, whatever it is, think about the audience and what do they want to hear from you. It's never about you, it's always about the audience. Think about competitors. Who else is taking up airtime or space in the field that you want to be an expert in? How many people went on LinkedIn and tried to find people like themselves to understand their competition? Come on, be gutsy, just own it. Hands up. All right, six of you. Vicious people, I love it. You have to know your competitors. And it really sucks, we have competition. Congratulations, you made it through the first round. You have a job. But know your competition. Know what inside your company. I'm not saying be brutal and backstabbing at all. That is not the message. But understand your competition as a company, but also more importantly, personally. Who are you competing against? In reality, it should just be yourself because you want to be the best you, but you have to acknowledge how other people are showing up. The reason you have to acknowledge how other people are showing up is only then will you see the opportunities you need to create for you. This is the biggest mistake a lot of my clients miss out on. How do they proactively create opportunities to show their brand? Standing out to get in. This is about building your brand, okay? So we've gone through discovery. We've gone through, now that you know your brand, because you go ask people because you're brave. Now that you define your brand, what do I want to be known for? And you've started to think about, how do I differentiate myself? What am I going to talk about? How am I going to stand out and be different? Now it's about building that brand. You want to build it like you would train for a marathon. Anybody run a marathon? Anybody done a half marathon? Two people. Did you just decide, like, wake up and go do it? Kinda? Okay, well, you're like 21, so congratulations. When you get a little older, you did train a little bit?
Yeah, no, I like woke up and decided.
Ah, but not the same day. Okay, good.
Right.
So you woke up one day, and then you trained. Okay, good, because I was like, oh, that's great. So it's about this repetition, right? You survived the marathon, the half marathon, right? You lived to tell about it. I did a Tough Mudder last year. I know I don't look like I could do one. My only two goals were not to die and to make it to the finish line. For those of you who don't know what a Tough Mudder is, it's like 12 miles of terribleness and obstacles. I only did it because I had some of my classmates from Georgetown with me, and we all made it through together. But it was this idea of repetition. I didn't go do the Tough Mudder the same day, and you didn't do your half marathon the same day. You went out and trained, and when you train, you build your muscles, you start paying attention to detail, you get known for that, you pick your projects, and you build your brand through repetition. This is one of my favorite quotes. Repetition makes reputation, reputation makes customers. What are you consistently doing to build your brand? Consistently. Training. And I gotta tell you, the perceptions are not in your favor as you enter the workforce. Let me give you some thoughts, because there are a lot of things that are in your favor, but these are some issues, I think, when it comes to generational challenges in the workforce. And if you want to chime in and engage in dialogue, let's do it. Here's the good news. Democratization of information. All that really means is Google. right? The good news is, if somebody says, how do I do this? Or if you ask yourself, I don't know what sales per square foot is, even though it's a little bit obvious from the title, you can go Google it and it'll tell you. You can find out information faster than any generation ever before. So what does that mean? That means you have a lot of ideas. And you're going to go to your meetings with your team leader and your CEO and your boss, and you're going to see your boss in the elevator, and you're going to say, I've got the answer. You're not going to say you Googled it. I trust you guys. The challenge is you have a lot of information, but you don't have all of the experience yet. So how do you balance sharing ideas and not have people think, man, they don't have this respect for hierarchy. I had to earn my stripes to have a voice here, and here they are sharing their voice. First of all, never lose your voice. But second of all, when you want to share an idea, think about how to do it diplomatically. Think about your audience and how do you do it. Think about timing in the right moment. Think about, do you have all the information you need to share your idea? So again, this just goes back to think about what you're going to do before you say it. So there is a perception that millennials, and I don't mean to group everybody, but I will, don't have a respect for hierarchy because they jump in meetings. I'm sharing this from feedback I've gotten from companies. But it's because you want to share ideas. So continue to want to do that. You should. Just think about how you're going to share the ideas. Think about how it might come across and how you're going to deliver it. So please share your voice. Just be thoughtful about it. Purpose-driven. Millennials, 73% of millennials volunteer in their community or give back in some way. That is more than any other generation ever. That's pretty powerful, right? How many people think they're going to change the world? You should all raise your hands if you... Yeah, okay, we're going to work on that. How many people think they're going to change the world? Thank you. Much better. There is an expectation, as there should be, that you are able to work and also have a life. There is no such thing as work-life balance. I'm just going to say that. There is work-life integration. Some days are going to be really hard. Some days will be easier, and you'll figure out the flow. Okay? So work-life integration. Sometimes, though, and I've heard this feedback, that can come across as people think they're entitled to leave work at 4 because they want to go have a life. What? Have a life. All I'm saying is be thoughtful about how you're showing up and how you are in the workplace, okay? How many people want a promotion within a year? You probably all want one, right? How many people think you're going to get one within a year? Some of you are like, oh, maybe. I don't want to raise my hand. Go for it. But recognize that that is harder now, and just be mindful of it. Don't come across as entitled. This is feedback I've gotten. I'm only sharing it. Just be mindful of it. Be purpose-driven. Go out to make a difference. But understand how sometimes that comes across, because you're in a workforce that has got all 4 generations in it. That's never happened before. So you've got to think about the generational differences. Deloitte does a really great job of matching older people, I'll just come out and say it, with new hires. Why? Because they both can learn from each other. Because senior folks don't know how to be digital. Junior folks aren't sure how to work and show up in the workplace. So just think about finding a buddy or a mentor that you can work with to help you assimilate into the workplace. The digital native, you have grown up with technology. My 2-year-old, this was 6 years ago, knew how to operate my phone better than me. He did something and like all of the things could be deleted at once. I was like, how'd you do that? Right? Turn it off. You guys already figured all of that out because you grew up with it. The good news is that allows you to multitask and deliver a heck of a lot more work. The challenge is sometimes that shows up as interpersonal skills are lacking. Don't text your boss unless you've agreed on that communication. I had an amazing intern over the summer. She really was amazing. And she goes, you know what? The best way to reach me is to text me. And I said, I love that you shared that with me, but because I am paying you, I'm pretty sure I can communicate with you through email, phone, in person, or text. So let's talk about how this is going to work. This is not a one-way demand. She didn't mean it that way at all. She was actually trying to help me. But understand that sometimes that comes across as, you are telling your boss how to communicate with you, and that's probably not how you want to show up. So just be mindful that although you're trying to be fast and efficient, Sometimes that comes across as not very interpersonal. When you send an email, type their name. Hi, Dylan. I thought you were really innovative in that last meeting. I really liked the idea you shared. I look forward to talking with you next week over coffee and hearing more about the project. Thanks, Jen. Don't forget to make it personal. You've got to connect with people. It'll take you 2 more seconds, but it'll be worth it in spades, okay? So think about those perceptions. Now, the 3 people that already have jobs, can you raise your hand again, or 2 people, some of you, that are already in the workforce? Literally, do you have a cube or a desk? Yes. You're like, yes, so yes. Okay, you're a hoteler. Okay, so you have a desk. How does your desk look? Oh. More like you. So what's something you did that's a personal touch? Okay. Uh-huh. Excellent. So what does that say about you? You like organization. You're paying attention to time management. You got a calendar, right? You got a picture. What's the picture of? Or it's a, oh, okay. So you get to use it to pin stuff up. So again, organized. That's telling part of your brand. You could have stacks of paper everywhere, and what would that tell me? Unorganized. Although data actually shows the more unorganized you are, the more productive you are. I actually don't know that I buy it. Don't go be disorganized. But my point is, even your cube is a reflection of your brand. Somebody's going to walk by it, and they're going to have an impression. In meetings, be aware of how you're showing up and your body language. Do not text in meetings. Do not open your laptop in meetings. Be fully present. I have people at any age who do that. Don't do it. Be fully present. Think about your body language. You guys all look amazing, so I'll go ahead and say this because I'm supposed to. Look professional. Don't come in with holy jeans and flip-flops unless everybody has agreed that that's the appropriate work attire. I talked a little bit about this earlier. Although you want to be brief, you don't want to forget the personal pieces. Dylan, I'm going to pick on Dylan again. Happy New Year. I hope you had a really great holiday. I look forward to connecting with you. Keep it personal. Remember that emotional connection we talked about earlier? Care about your employees and take a minute to express it. It will go a very long way. Do not use emoticons. I know they're cute and friendly. They're not professional, okay? Communication is still an art, so make sure you treat it that way. Think about how you're sending your emails or your presentations. Be really thoughtful, because that's reflecting your brand too. Sometimes, and I've been guilty of this, I'll be like, oh my God, I've got so much work to do, and just send out. But they can come across as like, hey, I need this report now. And Monica probably would be like, well, Jen wasn't very nice when she asked me for that report now. She doesn't know that I literally am scared about losing my job, and I need the report now, and it's nothing personal, but that's how she's gonna perceive it. So again, think about the audience when you're sending communications. Most of you have a LinkedIn profile. Love it. How many of you have professional headshots? A fair amount of you. Good. If you don't, at some point get one or have your friend who's a photographer take one. That first impression on LinkedIn, 6 to 10 seconds, that's how long people spend on your LinkedIn profile. Now, LinkedIn is a powerful tool. You should use it professionally and make connections. I give full talks on LinkedIn. But do make sure you're out here and think about how you want to reflect your company brand on your page. What do you want to put on there? So when you have other people come look at your page and they're trying to connect with you because you work at Neiman or somewhere else, how do they get in touch with you? Are you giving them the email, phone number? How do you make it easy for people to find you? So just a thought. But think about how you're building your brand, not just on LinkedIn, but Twitter, Facebook, etc. I'm going to come back to that. Facebook should be completely private. Nobody should be able to see anything on Facebook, just a thought. Twitter is a little different. You could use that to support your business, provided you've got approval from corporate communications. So we've talked about discover your brand. We've talked about define your brand, to differentiate it, and to build it. Now I want to talk about protect it. This is also one that people forget about. You don't want to build your brand the moment you need it. That's why you build your brand from the beginning. Because if you need it, it's too late. So when you think about protecting your brand, there really is this integrated strategy. One, and Susan talked about this earlier, how do you show up? How are you showing up? Let me give some examples. How do you show up on LinkedIn? All of you probably are going to have a page on the intranet site at your new company. What's your bio? What's your description? How are you showing up on Twitter? Did you know that, and this won't matter to you, so you can chuckle and be like, yes, I made it. 55% of recruiters change their mind about a candidate when they visit their social media profile. Can you believe it? 55%. So that means if I liked the two of you because I saw your resume and I went and looked online, I'm going to change my mind about one of you. That's pretty crazy. But I have literally heard of Goldman Sachs not hiring someone, not because of the interview or the resume, because they went and looked on Facebook and said, dude, your profile is not fit our company brand and we're no longer pursuing you. This was actually somebody in their mid-20s for a six-figure job. And that's how much personal brand is part of corporate brand, and you need to make sure you're keeping that in mind. So how do you show up? That's the proactive piece. There's a reactive piece. How are you listening? Companies listen, right? How do companies listen? Dylan, you're innovative. How do companies listen?
I guess reviews.
Reviews, online reviews, calls in the call center, feedback in store, right? So how do you listen? How would you guys listen for feedback on yourself? Yes. Body language cues. What's your name?
Garrett.
What else? Has anybody ever Googled themselves? How many people? Raise your hand. How many people have set up Google alerts on your name? Just a thought. You will be famous once. That's how I found out Jennifer Dalton is a New Jersey housewife. Not me. Different Jennifer Dalton. So body cues is a good one. Also ask for feedback. We talked about that. Set up a Google alert. Look at clout. See how much digital clout you have. How many of you are going into the marketing social media place or job in your role? Anybody? Nobody in social media? One? Okay, so you would care about clout. Are you on clout? Do you know your clout score? You just signed up? Do you remember, like, range-wise, roughly? Perfect. Awesome. So cloud is a digital platform. You can link all your social media channels into it, and it will tell you how much digital cloud you have, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, etc. For a social media person, sometimes they actually ask for that on your resume. If you want to see how much digital cloud you have, that's a good tool to use. Here's another one. Be provocative, but not polarizing. What should you not talk about in the workplace? Say it louder. Parties. That's going to come up. What else? Yes, politics. I'll come back to that. Religion. Don't talk about it. It's too provocative. Money. I like that one. Politics. Big winner. Relationships. I am glad you're happy. I don't want to hear about it. Okay? If you are close enough with your fellow employees, that is probably okay. If you're in the elevator with the CEO or your boss, I don't need to know a lot about your relationships. That's too close. So just be mindful of how much you're sharing. President's daughters. I just had to throw this one in there. No tweeting or Facebooking saying bad things about the president's daughters. You will get fired over it. Nobody heard about that in North Carolina? Yes, right? You're like, hello. So I just had to say it out of good conscience. Parties! Nice job, my man, over there. Don't be mean. Don't gossip. And I know it gets exciting when someone says, what's the latest news? Have you heard? Don't gossip. It might feel really good in the moment, but it will come back and bite you. So say only nice things. If you can't be nice, be quiet. It's okay if you're constructive, that's different. But don't be mean and no gossiping. Are we good? Yeah? Anybody want to add to this list? Anything else? No? All right. 10 things to remember day one. These are really important. I need someone to come practice on stage with me. Volunteer. Be gutsy, yes, please. You already practiced this earlier, so you're going to be amazing at it. She's going to smile and be confident, yes? Smile and be confident. Yeah. I'm Jen Dalton. I'm CEO of BrandMirror. What do you do?
Megan, nice to meet you. I'm a student at Santa Clara University.
Excellent. What are you going to be doing? Do you have a job?
Yes, I'm going to be a merchandise coordinator at Levi Strauss.
Aha. Say, pause. Let's start again. Hi, I'm Jen Dalton with BrandMirror. Tell me your corporate title and stuff.
Megan, nice to meet you. Merchandise coordinator at Levi Strauss.
Love it. When you go to meet your new employees who you're going to try to make your friends, that is how you want to introduce yourself. Give them context. Thank you very much, Megan.
Yeah,
I'll give you a book as well. These are good books too, not just ones I was trying to get rid of. Practice your professional introduction. If you're gonna have your own introduction, or if you're gonna have a hard conversation, always practice, okay? If you need to have a hard conversation with your boss or you're doing a professional introduction, do it in front of the mirror, do it in the car ride to work or the metro ride, just quietly. Practice saying it. You literally won't be able to introduce yourself because you haven't trained your muscles to be clear and loud if you don't practice. I know that sounds weird. Practice. Okay? Remember the names of your fellow employees. I know that sounds crazy. When you meet them the first time, remember their name. Think of a little story in your head, whatever helps you remember them. Because the next time you're in the hallway and say, hey, Dylan, what's going on? I really enjoyed talking to you. Let's have coffee. Dylan's going to be like, wow, Jen remembered my name. Be ready. Always have pen and paper. Be flexible and be prepared. When you come to a meeting, be prepared. If you can, look at the invite and see who's coming. Know who they are. Do your research. Ask lots of questions and be curious. Maybe not in big meetings, but like one-on-one, meet with people and ask them how they're doing, what's going on in their department, what are they most excited about? The what are you most excited about is like the number one question that opens people up. If you are interested, you will be interesting. Yes? Be interested and you'll be interesting. Any new networking events and you go to that, ask. And Bill talked about this earlier. Ask, well, what do you do? Well, how are you doing? What's the most exciting thing you're working on? What's coming next month? Send thank you notes. If you meet someone or you have a mentor and you're going out to lunch, write them a thank you note. Write them. I know that means like literally get a thank you note. Get it with your last name initial on it, whatever it is. Don't just do an email. Emails are really good. People don't do emails anyways. Written thank you note goes a really long way. How many people wrote thank you notes to the people who interviewed them? Some of you, good. It makes a huge difference. Here's a really big one. Know what's important to your team. What does your manager care about? The more you can help your team and your manager, especially helping your manager look more effective and be better, the better that will be for you. Learn about the company. How is it structured? How many departments? Who are the senior leaders? Be curious about your company. The more you know about it, the more effective a job you can do. Give, get. This is critical. It is not about you. If I send Dylan an email for the first time, it should not be about I need something from Dylan. Try to make it, Happy New Year, I'd love to take you for coffee. Help other people before you ask them for something. Sometimes that's unavoidable. Sometimes you need something from someone really quickly and you just gotta do it. Maybe walk over to their desk and ask them in person, not through email. The last one, my sort of bonus hint here, is always do the front page test. If whatever you're gonna do, say, or wear, if it were on the front page tomorrow, online, Huffington Post, or literally a newspaper, would you change your mind about what you're gonna do, say, or wear? Front page test. Okay. What people are looking for in you. When I go out and talk with executive headhunting firms, or when I go out and talk with recruiters or companies, this is what they want. Be curious and add insight. They want you to be curious and add your own thoughts. It's a war for talent. You were hired for a reason, so come up with your own thoughts and ideas and constantly be thinking. Determination and resilience. You will have your first annual review. Hopefully, it's amazing and wonderful. There probably will be things that they're going to say, could you work on this? Or this is a weakness. Could you focus on developing that? Take it in stride. Don't take it personally. It's really hard. because we leave school and we want to be awesome at everything. Hopefully we all got A's and B's or whatever. We've always thought we were amazing. Our parents told us that. You're going to go to your first job and they're going to say, you're kind of good, strong, maybe very strong, but you need to work on this, this, and this. Just listen and absorb the feedback. It's not personal. It's okay. So be resilient, okay? Take feedback. It's okay. Be a team player that can lead. You've got to be able to lead. Be authentic. We talked about authenticity, being yourself. That is the biggest value you can bring. You don't want to be like everybody else. That's not the point. You weren't hired to be like the person next to you. You were hired for what you bring. So constantly focus on figuring out the best you and bring that when you show up. Lastly, be engaged and be interested. Ask questions. Understand the company growth. Understand where they're headed and why. Be engaged and be interested. These are core skills that they are going to be looking for, and if you bring them to bear, it will pay dividends. You will have a $10 million brand. No kidding. All right, last exercise, and I'm going to ask for some volunteers to share. I want you to pick three things that you're going to do after this session based on the talk we've had and write them down. Because if you don't write stuff down, it's never going to happen. It gets stuck in your head. So think of three things you're going to do. It could be if you're one of the few people that didn't have a LinkedIn profile, go make a LinkedIn profile. It could be make your Facebook page private. It could be pick out three things to bring to your cube the first day that represent you. It could be go research your company more. They don't have to be hard. Just think of three things. If you want to go big or go home, think of your purpose and figure it out. I'm not going to pick on Dylan or Monica because I picked on them a lot. Who would like to share some of their things? Yes. What's your name?
Sarah.
Sarah. Writing down your personal passions, values, and goals. Was that like a 3-for-1?
It was 3-in-1.
Ah, perfect. Efficient. All right, anybody else want to share? That's very good, by the way. Thank you. Yes. Purchasing thank you note cards. Good one. What's your name?
Carla.
Carla. Thank you, Carla. Anybody else? Yes.
Social media on cloud.
Yes. Excellent. Anyone else? Yes. To be your own brand ambassador. You get my last and third book. You're such a good suck up. That was good. I like that. Yes. Please. Set up a Google alert. Excellent. So managing and building your personal brand doesn't have to be hard. It's just a drip strategy, right? It's every day, bit by bit. Think of one thing you're going to do that day to build your brand. Maybe it's send a nice email, send a thank you card, how you're going to show up in a meeting, confident, happy, ready to go. It doesn't have to be hard. I want to leave you with this quote because we talked about emotions and feelings. I've learned that people will forget what you said. People will forget what you did. But people will never forget how you made them feel. Thank you very much for your time. I appreciate it. You guys are going to rock and be awesome. Thank you. One last thing, because I love you guys so much. First three people to follow me on Twitter and message me, I will do free coaching sessions for you. And I'm going to be here for another half hour. So if you do it now, I'll talk to you now. Thank you, guys.